anatomical classifications. Virchow, Wegener, and Fraser, they all offered anatomical classifications, which were not of much use, because no matter where these lesions were, they were almost the same type. Similarly, the next set of classifications were embryological. And once again, these lesions had very limited embryological variation. And so this was also not a classification worthwhile. So while we were studying, the classification which was in vogue was Mulliken and Glowa. The anatomical and the embryological classifications were not of much help to us. So while we were studying, the classification that was popular was the Mulliken and Clive. And later on, Prof. Ian Jackson gave his classification along the lines of vascular dynamics. And it was this classification which eventually became the basis of Professor Guleria's classification, which we are following nowadays. Next, please. So in the meantime, there was a classification propounded in 1996 by the International Society of Study of Vascular Anomalies. And these people, they offered a classification which, according to which, the vascular anomalies were either tumors or malformations. In the set of tumors, these were hemangiomas, meningoendotheliomas or the angiosarcoma. Whereas the malformations were either slow flow type, which were capillaries, or fast flow type, which were arterial, arteriovenous fistula, and arteriovenous malformations. Next. There were also a third group, which was a combination of both vascular malformations and overgrowth. These again were either slow flow type or fast flow type. The slow flow types were Klippel-Trenaunay syndrome, which was capillary, lymphatic, and venous malformation. Proteus syndrome, which was capillary, lymphatic, and venous malformation, along with lipoma and connective tissue tumors. And Maffucci syndrome, which was vascular malformation with enchondromas and exostosis. The fast flow were two, Parkes-Weber syndrome and Bunyan-Reilly-Rubalcava syndrome. Now, what was Professor Guleria's concept? Professor Guleria said that these lesions owe their identity to the presence of, which can be lymphatic, which can be venous, but there are various types of channels. Now, it is the behavior of the dominant channel that decides the behavior of these lesions. And the behavior of the dominant channel is dependent upon their location in the vascular tree, their size, and the rate of flow through them. And again, the behavior of the dominant channel in turn decided the investigative modalities that we are going to identify these lesions with, as well as the therapeutic modalities they would respond to, like laser, radio frequency, and embolization and surgery. So now, what was the logic of our investigation? Whatever investigations we were doing now was to classify these vascular anomalies into four clinically identifiable groups, which were management oriented. These four clinically identifiable groups were small channel high flow lesions, like congenital hemangioma of infancy, small channel low flow lesions, like capillary, lymphatic, and venous malformations, or a combination of all these, large channel low flow lesions, which were vascular malformations, and large channel high flow lesions, which were arteriovenous malformations, or arterioAVMs. So the concept was that these vascular anomalies, they owe their identity to the presence of channels. There are many types of channels, but the dominant channel decides the behavior pattern of the vascular anomaly. The dominant channel in turn is dependent upon the location in the, their location in the vascular tree, their size, and the rate of flow through them. And the behavior of the dominant channel also decided the investigative modalities that will identify these lesions, as well as the therapeutic modalities to which they are going to respond. So by these set of investigations, ultrasound, Doppler, CT, MRI, angiography, DSA, we tried to identify and categorize all these vascular anomalies into four clinically identifiable and management-oriented groups. These were small channel high flow lesions, small channel low flow lesions, large channel low flow lesions, and large channel high flow lesions. Next. So working classification is that they are either hemangiomas or vascular malformations, which are either low flow type or high flow type. Hemangiomas. The first hemangioma is congenital hemangioma of infancy. This is a different hemangioma altogether. This is a small channel high flow lesion. It is present at birth and fully formed. It can be observed in the antenatal scans. They are of two types, rapidly involuting congenital hemangioma or rich and non-involuting congenital hemangioma. The rapidly involuting congenital hemangiomas are associated with congestive cardiac failure and thrombocytopenia. Then we come to the regular hemangioma, which we see most of the time, and these are infantile hemangiomas. These are small channel, low flow lesions. Unlike the congenital hemangioma of infancy, which was small channel, high flow lesion. So these appear in the first month of life. They are not present at birth. They proliferate in the early neonatal period. They involute between 6 to 10 months, and they completely involute by 5 to 12 years. There are three overlapping phases: proliferative phase, early involution, and late involution. And all these three phases are running concurrently. That is, they can be seen in the same patient. In the center, we can see the involution taking place. In the periphery, we can see the proliferation taking place. And all three phases can be seen in the same patient. So this is a typical example of how a hemangioma gradually involutes. What I would like you to notice in this is that this involution is not without a trace. It is leaving behind a scar. Now, you can well imagine this scar may be acceptable on the trunk, but will it be acceptable on the face? So to say that because it is a hemangioma, we will allow it to involute is not always correct when the areas are exposed. What are the complications that we see in hemangioma? Ulceration, obstruction of hollow spaces and tubes, resulting in deafness, dysphagia, dyspnea, and platelet trapping. The condition is called Kesebeck-Merritt syndrome, and a large number of ocular and orbital complications. These are amblyopia, proptosis, refractory error, blepharoptosis, squints, and optic atrophy. Treatment. The treatment of hemangioma is wait, watch, and reassure only if you can afford to do so. Steroids, propranolol, interferon alpha 2A, intralesional OK-432, which is a denatured streptococcal protein, lasers, and surgery. Steroid therapy. Why do we give steroids? Because steroids hasten the onset and the rate of involution. How do we know it? Because steroids were seen to inhibit vascular endothelial growth factor expression and subsequent proliferation in hemangioma stem cells in a murine hemangioma model. How much do we give? Lowest effective dose for the shortest period of time. We start with 2 to 3 milligrams per kg body weight per day for 2 to 3 weeks. Follow it up with 0.75 milligrams per kg body weight per day thereafter for 6 weeks. And we avoid steroids after 1 year of age. Propranolol. Propranolol acts by blocking the beta adrenergic receptors and it causes vasoconstriction. Thus, there is a reduction in the vascularity and the hemangioma becomes paler and softer. There is reduced endothelial proliferation. All this is good, but propranolol causes bradycardia, hypotension, bronchospasm, peripheral vasoconstrictions, and fingers and toes become cold and blue. Weakness and fatigue, which in a child is shown by floppiness and disinterest in the surroundings, sleep disturbances, and hypoglycemia. Ethambutol is not a drug to be written in OPD. The patients in our setup are always admitted in pediatric intensive care unit when we first start propranolol. We start with 1 milligram per kg per day for two divided doses. Increase it to 2 milligrams per kg per day in two divided doses after 4 to 7 days. And the drug is given up to 12 to 16 months of age, and then we taper it down. We constantly do ECG, heart rate and BP hourly, and blood glucose 4 hourly in these children when we admit start propranolol therapy. So propranolol is not a drug to be given in small strawberry hemangiomas. That is not an indication of propranolol. Indications are periorbital and retrovulvar hemangiomas, perioral hemangiomas, large facial hemangiomas,